strange man entered the bar and sat at a table in a secluded part of the room. He was a heavyset man with large eyes and shifted uncomfortably in his chair. He looked tired and irritable and yet was carefully observing everything that was happening around him. His eyes darted back and forth at all the customers and then shifted towards the girls waiting tables. I immediately felt a chill when his eyes locked with mine. There was something about him that made me feel very uneasy. He lifted his hand and gestured me to come to him. He kept looking at me as I reluctantly approached him. I have been a Hooters girl for a little over 4 years now. The work has had its share of high and lows while I navigated my way through medical school. But it has helped me pay my bills while also allowing me to look after my 5-year-old nephew. Anyways, this was increasingly looking like one of those uncomfortable nights at the workplace. "Welcome to Hooters. I am Stacy. What can I get you?" I asked. He continued to stare at me in the face for a while and finally growled back, "Beer and chicken wings." I smiled and nodded. Even as I turned back to place the order, I could feel his gaze fall upon me, like he was measuring my every move. Creepy. He had a voracious appetite, cleaned out 5 plates of wings, and chugged 6 bottles of beer. When I finally approached him with the bill, he asked, "How much?" "That would be $147, I said.
"I meant, how much for the night?"
"I am not that kind of girl, and this isn't that kind of place either," I replied back calmly. This was not the first time a drunk customer was making a lewd pass at me. I placed the bill at his table, and he suddenly caught my hand.
"Where do you live? You have nothing to worry about. It's just single night of fun. No harm done, right?"
He smiled back to reveal 2 missing front teeth. I yanked my hand away from his grasp and reported the incident to my manager. He was quickly escorted out of the building after being made to foot the bill. He looked back at me one final time before heading out. When my shift finally ended, I was exhausted. I packed some dinner for my nephew and got out of the restaurant to get to my car. As I was walking in the parking lot, I saw an old black sedan with tinted windows slowly go past me. I got in my car and started driving. It looked like the same sedan I had seen in the parking lot. Was this the same guy who was at the bar? I thought to myself while also panicking at the same time. I stepped on the gas to create more distance between me and the other car. The sedan picked up in speed as well. Every time I slowed, the driver also slowed, and when I hit the accelerator, he did the same. I was being followed. There was no doubt. I slowed down at a traffic signal when the light turned red. Luckily, the sedan and I were separated by another car in between. I sped off before the light turned green and kept driving without stopping. A few moments later, when I looked back in the rearview mirror, there was no sign of the sedan anymore. I had a huge sigh of relief. As I kept driving, I suddenly felt a piercing pain run through my body. The sedan appeared out of nowhere and crashed into my side window. As the black sedan crushed into my car, I caught a glimpse of the driver for a split second. He was the same man who I saw at the bar with a frightening smile on his face. I woke up from my bed with beads of sweat dripping down my face. I ran my hands over my body to check if I was hurt. It was a dream. I then slowly looked at the clock and realized it was already 7 a.m. I was running late for medical school and my nephew was late for his school as well. Woke up, got my nephew, got him ready, and prepared a quick breakfast for the two of us. As I saw my nephew Rudy enter the building, thoughts of the recent years flashed before my eyes. Rudy was the son of my sister, Emily. Emily and I were inseparable as kids, but had a falling out in our late teens. As a result, I had cut off all contact with my sister. So after not talking to her for more than 7 years, it was a shock for me when I received a call from Child Services asking if I would take in Rudy. Emily had died in an accident, and they could not trace Rudy's father. To have not been a part of her life all these years and to find out about her son in this manner really broke my heart. I felt a huge pang of guilt when I learned of her demise, and it remains the biggest regret of my life. As I reached the medical college, I rushed to the lab to be in time for class. All the students were already assembled around a table and listening to the professor. As I inched closer to get a better look, my face turned white. I was looking at the naked, lifeless body of the man who came to the bar last night. There was a huge knife wound in his chest. What on earth is going on? Why is this man repeatedly coming into my life in the most bizarre ways? As I was beginning to question my own sanity, the professor took a scalpel in his hand and asked all of us to lean forward to get a closer look. A wave of uneasiness enveloped me. It was bad enough to face abuse from this pervert, but now I have to see him get medically disemboweled? I suddenly felt like vomiting, and I cupped my mouth with my hands to prevent any sort of gag reflex. As the professor worked on his intestines, I could hold no longer, and I barfed all over John Doe. My morning's breakfast of cereal and oats forming a nice little puddle in the place where once his stomach was. When I slowly lifted my head, I could see the professor looking at me speechless and horror-stricken. He then came to his senses, his face turning a deep crimson red. He started yelling at me at the top of his voice. I became even more pale as his voice echoed through the entire building. I could feel like I was going to faint as my legs began to give away. My batchmates caught hold of me before I fell to the floor and helped me get to the cafeteria. They gave me some electrolytes to deal with the nausea. After a few minutes, I felt much better, even though I was still shaken from the episode. I then received a phone call from my nephew's school. It seems there was some large suspicious man looking around the school for my nephew. The panic started once again. Who is at that school now? I am the only family Rudy has anymore. So why would anybody come looking for him? And who was the man lying dead at the cadaver lab? What on earth is going on? I kept repeating to myself as I rushed towards my car. When I reached the school, Rudy was sitting by the principal's office. The man who had come asking for him had left abruptly when the principal insisted on calling me first. I was relieved to find Rudy safe and thanked the teachers for being vigilant. I decided to take Rudy back home. Fear and paranoia were gripping me. It was a crazy day, and I could do with some rest before contemplating my next course of action. As I opened the door to my apartment, I could feel my heart stop in my chest. The man was standing in my living room. He had tossed my home and was clearly looking for something. He saw me standing by the door, and my nephew was there as well. An evil grin appeared on his face. As I thought of fleeing, he lunged quickly at me, caught me by the hair, and pulled me back into the apartment. He slapped me so hard that I crashed into a piece of furniture. He then reached for my nephew and growled, "Where is it? Where is it, little boy? Where is that musical box?" My nephew started crying. "I don't know," he cried out loud. "I don't know any box." He was weeping as he was speaking. "Don't play with me, stupid boy," he growled back. "Where is the musical box your mother left you?" he added as he cornered Rudy and pinned him against the wall. He was really hurting my nephew now. For the first time, things began to make sense. When I received a call from Child Services following Emily's death and met Rudy for the first time, he was holding onto a small music box. It was his most prized possession. He never let go of it and carried it with him every day to school as well. I saw Rudy's backpack strewn on the floor. The box must definitely be inside. Should I tell the guy about it to save our lives? Or will he kill us both after getting his hands on it? Then I saw he was carrying a gun in the small of his back. I slowly scrambled to my feet and lunged at him with all my might. Both of us hit the ground as I fell on top of him. I managed to lift the gun from his trousers and pointed it at him. "Do you even know how to use that thing? I wouldn't recommend you to do anything stupid, or you will be really sorry." "Who are you? What do you want with us?" I asked him with the gun still pointed at him. He slowly began to move forward. "Stop right there, or I will shoot," I yelled back. But he lunged at me, and I fired two shots. We both crashed to the floor, his massive frame on top of me as he lay there lifeless. I tried to wiggle free, but he was a heavy man. I could see a puddle of blood forming around us. Rudy came running towards me to help, and with great difficulty, I managed to break free from him. I then called the cops. When the police came, I learned about the identity of the man. He was Tony Sanchez and a notorious bank robber. He also had a twin brother by the name of Curtis Sanchez. Both of the Sanchez brothers were arrested following a heist, but the authorities never managed to recover the stolen loot. The police also recovered a small folder from a black sedan parked near my apartment, which of course belonged to Tony. It had a picture of Curtis and Emily, who was cradling an infant Rudy in her arms. Curtis was killed during his stint in prison when he got involved in a gang fight. The body I saw in the lab must have been that of Curtis. There was also a picture of me and Emily smiling. So that is how Tony managed to track me down following his release. He was in some way looking to recover his stash. After the police left, Rudy and I took the music box from the bag. I closely inspected it to see if there was something valuable about it. Rudy then pressed a button which opened a secret compartment. Inside was a small key which looked like it belonged to some safety locker. There also was a slip of paper which contained a bank name and account number. The following day, I tracked down the bank location and got the safety locker opened. There was a small pouch inside. It was full of diamonds. As a horror film director, I am often in search of haunted stories. Whenever I tell people what I do, they often jump on the opportunity and tell me all sorts of stories. However, last month, when I was traveling back home from a movie show, I stopped for a tea break in a small town called Hooterville. However, when I entered a breakfast diner early that day to just have some food on my drive, I met a very peculiar gentleman. He said that he was the owner of the diner and a few small businesses in the town. While we were talking, the topic shifted to my occupation, and I told him what I do for a living. Just like everyone else, he too had a story to share with me. However, his story was a personal one. Unlike other people who often tell stories of incidents that have happened with some distant relative or friend, this man was narrating something that happened to him.
When I planned to settle back in my hometown after I had successfully done business all over the country and even overseas, I decided to open a small fast food chain in this small town. Back then, Hooters were a rage due to the distinctive uniform of the staff and the food. So I decided to buy the franchise and open a small outlet in that small town. I hired some young people from the town as staff, and I became the manager. I thought it would be fun until I get the restaurant in line and then appoint a different manager. On the opening day itself, probably half the town was down there to grab a bite in the new restaurant. The business was going well for the first several months. But soon, one by one, the staff members started to quit. I wondered what the issue was. That's when a waitress told me that the staff members who quit were mostly from the late night shift, and they claimed to have seen ghosts in the restaurant. Of course, I did not believe in all that shit. In all my years of business, I had not seen a single ghost. So I brushed it off, hired a few other people, and continued my business. A few weeks later, more staff members quit. Again, the one working the night shift. This time, I knew something was serious, so I decided to take up the night shift myself and see if there were any ghosts I could spot. Unfortunately, that night, I didn't spot anything. So I told the staff to calm down and get back to work. There were no ghosts there. Just 2 days later, a bunch more of my staff members quit. Now I was severely understaffed, and if this continued, I would have to close the Hooters. So I decided to do a bit of digging into this place's history. And what I found blew my mind. I went to the local library and looked into the history of the town. Even though I had grown up in this town, I knew nothing more than the basics about the place, the founding fathers, etc. Never in our town had anyone experienced anything paranormal. So what I found out shocked me. The land on which the place was built had a house in the 1800s in which a family of four lived, parents and their two kids. I had demolished that house to build the Hooters. The family was very poor and worked as laborers. One day, the father of the family was accused of stealing, and as a punishment, the whole family was killed, including the kids. Later, it was found that it was a false accusation. However, no one in the town bothered to give a proper burial to the family, and their house and land were abandoned as well. Until I bought it. So there was a possibility that the place could be haunted by the spirits of those dead people. My staff members complained that the utensils were often misplaced. The meat and vegetables rotted before time, and all the chairs and tables used to be moved overnight. Some staff members even saw ghostly appearances. But nothing in the library told me what to do about it. So, I decided to call a paranormal investigator called Harrison, who I found online. After listening to my whole story over the phone, he told me that the only way to get rid of these spirits is to free them. And to do so, I would have to bury 4 empty coffins in the cemetery dedicated to each one of them and pray for the family with the help of a priest. He also suggested getting the whole place blessed and cleansed by a priest or a holy person.
So how did it go?
I finally asked after listening to this man's story. That's the crazy part, son. When I planned to do the suggested ritual, I had a weird dream that night. It was like a scene from a horror movie. I saw a woman holding 2 kids in her arms, hiding underneath the kitchen table, while they could hear gunshots and yelling in the living room. Then, a few men entered the kitchen and dragged the trio into the front yard of their house, and shot the kids in front of the eyes of the mother, and then shot the mother too. The woman who had just been shot turned and, as if she was talking to me, said,
"Make them pay."
And the dream ended. I could not understand what was happening, so I just let it go as a dream and did the ritual on the following day. I even got the restaurant blessed by the priest and then asked the old staff to come back to work, as I thought the paranormal was dealt with and the spirits were free. But that same night, another waitress spotted a ghostly woman, and this time, the woman seemed angry. I contacted Harrison again and told him what had happened. As if on cue, he asked me if I had seen any weird dream recently. That's when I told him about my dream. He then said that the spirits won't be free until you bring justice to them. But how was that possible? The perpetrators were long dead, and there was no way to punish them now. But Harrison was a smart fellow. He suggested that I should bring the story of their death to the forefront and let all the townspeople know what crime had been committed in their town decades ago. I did that by writing an article about the family and their story in our local newspaper. From that day onwards, I have not seen the ghosts at all. I was a curious person by nature, so I could not help myself from asking the old man where this haunted hooter is and if he could take me there. Unfortunately, son, I closed that Hooters last year and started another business unsteady.
Well, sure, but can you at least take me to the place where the Hooters was? I'd like to just see it.
He must have seen something in my eyes which made him smile a genuine bright smile. Well, son, then you must know you are sitting in the very place the haunted Hooters was and the dead family's house before it. I just converted the Hooters into a diner now. His statement left me dumbstruck for a second. Till then, the man had already left, but I had a lot of questions to ask the old man. And he mentioned that he was the owner of the place, so the staff must have his address or contact information.
"Excuse me, miss," I called the waitress. "Can you give me any information about the man who was just sitting in front of me? He said he is the owner of the diner."
The waitress looked at me funny and then said,
"Sir, for the past hour, you are the only one sitting in this booth, alone."
I did not know what to do or say. Instead, I just paid my bill and left the town behind, never to return.
As a college student, I was working at Hooters as a waitress. If you have ever been to Hooters, it's no news that the uniform there is really tight and borderline vulgar. As I could not get a job anywhere else, I decided to work there on a temporary basis. Our manager was a middle-aged man who was creepy as hell. He was fat and bald and had a few teeth missing and loved to flirt with the girls who worked there. We all steered clear of him. On my first day there, a waitress told me to distance myself from the manager. I was one of the youngest ones working there, and I was still learning the work. On more than one occasion, the manager offered to teach me, but I refused and told him the other waitresses were helping me out, which was true. One evening, after my class when I went to Hooters for my shift there, there were a bunch of cops all around the place. My first thought was maybe someone attempted to rob the place. However, as I moved close, two medics were carrying a big body bag on a stretcher towards an ambulance, which I had not noticed before. I got concerned and spotted two of the girls who worked with me standing by a bench.
"Hey, Gina, what's going on? Didn't you hear?"
Gina said.
"Heard what?"
"There's been a murder in our Hooters and an investigation is going on."
"Wait, who was killed?"
She did not look too sad about the fact that someone was killed at the very place we worked every day.
"The manager. He was killed. More like hanged above the cash register,"
Gina told me.
"Oh, that's awful."
I was a little shaken, as it was the very counter where we girls loved to chat.
"Is it? That man was a creep. He had it coming for a long time."
It was a little strange to watch Gina be so hateful, as she was always the happiest one. Soon, a female cop approached us and started asking each of us some questions. I was new, so I wasn't able to give many answers. However, Gina had a lot to say. The investigation was in process, but the cops let Hooters get back in business in less than 3 days. I had expected the work environment to be gloomy and tense. However, it was the exact opposite. The girls were super happy, and the mood was cheerful. The cops showed up a few times, but the investigation was hitting dead end after dead end. No one knew who killed the manager until one evening when I was working late and heard someone in the manager's office. I thought maybe someone must have been in there. I went to check, but no one was around. However, the computer was turned on and the chair was positioned the way our dead manager liked. It was a weird coincidence, but I decided to turn off the computer and leave. All the girls had already left to drink and grab a bite before returning home. I was the only one left behind. The next day, as I was locking up, I again heard someone typing in the manager's office. The moment I entered, I saw the same scene from the night before. The PC was on and the chair turned. I again turned the PC off, repositioned the chair, and left. The same thing continuously happened for 4 more days. That's when I knew something was off. The next day, when I went to turn the computer off, I decided to take a look at what was on the PC. The girls had told me the manager was creepy, but there were folders upon folders on his PC containing pictures of his family. In each photo, he seemed like a good man, a nice father, and a great husband. Plus, he had never been weird with me, and neither had I seen him do anything to the other girls. So why did the girls hate him? Last but not least, I decided to go through the financial documents of the restaurant. It seemed like right after the manager's death, there was a big transfer made to an account. That was weird, as no one had touched the manager's laptop except me after his death. So who made the wire transfer? I knew something suspicious was going on, and this could even tie to the manager's murder. I dug a bit more and stumbled upon a deleted video. It was the CCTV footage of the night the manager was murdered. The footage showed a group of women wearing black jumpsuits entering the restaurant through the back door. They all headed toward the manager's office and dragged him out of the office. They started torturing him in different ways. There was no volume to the footage, but I could make out the women were asking him for something. The manager kept refusing, and the women kept on torturing him. Finally, one of them looped a rope around his head, and they hanged him. As soon as they made sure he was dead, they left immediately. I just stared at the screen looking at the lifeless body of my boss. As soon as the video ended, I emptied the contents of my stomach in the trash can next to me. It was extremely gory to watch random women kill my boss. Just as I was about to shut down the computer, I noticed another deleted video. This video was short, only 6 minutes long. In that video, I saw Gina enter the manager's room a few days later and leave just as fast as she had come in. However, I spotted something odd in both videos. One of the women in the first video had the same shoes as Gina from the second video, which means Gina was one of the murderers. I knew I had to report this to the cops, but I also had to present the evidence to the cops. Back then, it wasn't as easy as it is today to send videos. The next day, I got a pen drive to cope with those videos. However, I could not do it while the girls were around. I tried to be friendly with them, but it was tough. The more I noticed them, the more I saw similarities between the behaviors and body language of the women in the videos and those girls. By the time my shift ended, I was convinced the staff had killed the manager for money. I told them that I would be glad to lock up after them and that they could leave if they wanted. I copied the videos and even the details of the wire transfer. The cops did their job, and the next day all the girls were arrested in their Hooters uniforms. They did not know how the cops found out about their plans, and I had no intention of telling them I had snitched on them. The cops later let me know that the girls were blackmailing the manager into giving them money. When he refused, they decided to badmouth him by telling everyone he was harassing them, but still the manager did not budge, so they planned his murder and stole the money. Gina sent the money to her account, and the girls split it later. All the girls were given life imprisonment for the murder of an innocent man and robbery, and they still don't know who ratted out their information. However, I'm still confused about who was using the manager's computer at night. Was it his ghost trying to seek justice through me? Let me know what you guys think.